What's up, friends? It's Mikhail with Wealth and Sharing Equity Properties, also known as Wise Properties. And today, I'm standing in front of one of the three properties that I was able to pick up in 1 month using only $2,500. Now, this is a short-term rental. I'm going to walk you guys through it so you can see how it looks. I'm also going to talk about the numbers behind it, how I was able to accomplish it in the first place, and how you can learn to do the same. So follow me. Guys, welcome inside the house. Now this is a 3-bed, 2-bath house. It's about 1,200 square feet, and it's actually a new build. So as we walk through here, you're gonna kind of see some appliances that look new, clean, that you know look like they were just inserted or just built, and that's because it just was. So I think this property was built in, like, last year. I got it last year. So let's take a look. So here's one of the bedrooms. And I got most of this stuff from Wayfair, queen bed. I didn't spend a lot of money. I wanted to go with this color though. So you can kind of see when you look at this this sheet comforter, and then this pillow, the sham and this pillow, you can see the same color aesthetic throughout. So that was very important. My sister helped me a lot with decorating this place. I really wish I could take the credit for being very designed, aesthetically pleasing. So. Here's a bathroom, smaller bathroom up here, but it gets the job done, of course. We didn't really need a lot for this house, so some of you guys might like look and say, hey, you could have done this, Mikhail, you could have done that. You're probably right, but when you're looking at getting an Airbnb property, you want to look at current inventory. So what does that mean? Take a look at what's currently on the market for your area. Now, not to get too much into the area, but I'm right by a lake. It's almost a lakefront property. And I'm kind of looking around to see what other Airbnbs look like out here. This is by far, hands down, without a doubt, the nicest looking Airbnb. I could have one bedroom in each and it'd be the nicest Airbnb, honestly. And so that's why I spent maybe $4,000 or so in just dressing it up. But I also wanted to make sure I had the proper amount of bedrooms and everything like that. So you see here, this is a twin bedroom. And what this does is this increases the amount of beds you can have on Airbnb. And, you know, of course, people are going to say, you could have done this, could have done that. Yeah, maybe, but this gets the job done. I'm going to talk about how this place has performed thus far. So let's go downstairs. Now, of course, two bedrooms are up here. One downstairs, the primary bedroom and primary bathroom. And we'll take a look here at the living room. Now, the living room is the best part of the house to me because it's just so aesthetically pleasing and it just looks really good, as you can see here in a second. So, to look at the kitchen, again, all new appliances. I'm pretty sure I got most of this stuff from Target or something. I don't even know. Stuff like this, you know, this is a value add. And then also you can actually come here and see, welcome to your retreat. So my realtor actually got me this and I had to figure out a place to put it. So I just put it there and then got coffee and then some champagne and wine bottles they don't have anything in them, just for decoration. But yeah, so this is the living room. Let's go take a look at some other features. So. Got fishing poles here, that's important. Now, I talked about the community a little bit, but we're right by Lake Livingston. So it was important to make sure that I had the fishing poles here for our guest use. We also have a private golf course. So you might have seen when I was walking to the living room that I had a golf club set right there by the TV, which I'll show you in a second, but right there by the TV. And that's because, of course, we have this private golf course. So we wanted to make sure we had everything that people may need whenever they're here. Visiting, right? So let's take a look at this second bathroom and the third bedroom. So you'll kind of see I went with this blue aesthetic here for most of downstairs, right? Lighter blue, a little bit darker blue, and that was really important because you know, when you're taking pictures, especially if they're professionally done, you want to make it kind of seem a little bit uniform, right? Even in the kitchen and the living room, you know, there's dark blue there, there's the gold aesthetic there, the yellow aesthetic there, and then you see here, blue aesthetic here, blue chair, and then blue sham, blue pillow, blue sheets. So it all comes together that way, and it's a huge value add if you can go in and make sure that your place looks good. That's half the battle, is to make sure it looks good, right? You might get to the Airbnb and the roof might be caved in and you might have, you know, whatever all over the floor and it's just a mess, right? But if you take the right pictures, you can make that seem like a 5-star hotel. Now, you're gonna have some issues when it comes to reviews and everything, but for the booking, then you're gonna do pretty well if you can dress it up to make it look really nice. So I wanted to point out one more thing while we were here in the living room. I talked about the dark blue aesthetic, dark blue chairs, black dining table. Dark blue on the rug, black sofa. Then I got this gold aesthetic here, gold yellow, gold, gold, and of course the clock is gold as well. So all these things are huge, huge, especially when they get here. Now, a lot of people may not pay attention to the details when they're scrolling on their phone, but when they get here, they're gonna be like, oh, this place is so nice, and they're gonna notice it. And it might even be subconsciously, they may see stuff like, oh, this is really nice, but they don't know the reason is because it's color coordinated. So I love this place, it's done pretty well. I've had it on the market for a little over a month now. In the first month, it did $1,600, and my monthly payments is about $600. So you can do the calculations, but we're also gonna talk about that in more detail, plus actually what happened that month when it came down to me buying the three properties and how I was only able to spend $2,500. So let's sit down and talk about that. So let's get started. All right, so for the moment you guys have been waiting for, Mikhail, how are you able to buy three properties? How much money did you make off these three properties, and how could you only use $2,500? This is something we're gonna dive into right now, but let me preface that by saying, this is not one of these get rich quick schemes. This is not something that you can roll out of bed and decide you can do tomorrow. This is not something easily replicable. Now, it can be, but it's going to take a lot of work, which no one wants to hear. It's gonna take a lot of studying, which no one wants to do, and a lot of time that no one's willing to give up. So before I get into how I was able to do this, I want you to know that I didn't do this easily, and this is something that took a lot of time and effort into being able to accomplish and learn so I could put myself in the position to do this, right? Because you could do all the right things and still not be at the right spot at the right time. And I'm gonna talk about how I was in the right spot at the right time for one of the properties. So take this house for example. Nice house. I spent $0. $0 for down payment and any other closing costs. Now, let's get into the financials of it. I have a loan on this property for $118,000. I paid $0 down. I got an FHA mortgage and got down payment assistance. Easy, right? This is in November, it is now February, and that was easy for me to do at the time. So I got a down payment assistance, so, and what ended up happening was, is that they actually also pay for closing costs and everything else. So I paid $200 in earnest, and that earnest money was refunded back to me at closing. So the loan was for $118,000. It got appraised, this house got appraised for $155,000, right? So right there, that's $37,000 in equity with no money in. The only money I have into this property is furniture, which I told you guys I spent about $4,000 roughly. So I was able to get into a house that's right near a lake for $0, and I got $37,000 back in equity, right? And on top of that, it's cash flowing. My monthly payment is about $660. I have cleaning expenses for about $300-$400 a month, depending on how many bookings I have. I have no property management. Well, I do have property management. They take 10% out of what I make per month. So if I make $2,000, they take $200, right? And that's it. That's really it.
And data says I should make anywhere from $2,800 to $3,500 a month in peak months, right? Now, it's February, it's cold, this isn't a great month, but even in the conditions that I'm in currently, we still were able to bring in $1,600 in month one. Month one, we brought in $1,600, and I ended up walking away with somewhere around $850 or so when you deduct all my expenses and everything. So I got a cash flowing property, which will bring me in the summertime, for example, around $3,500 a month in revenue. I may keep, let's say, $2,600. That's $2,600 over 3 months. That's ended up being $7,800? That's over $7,000 in 3 months for a house that I paid zero for. And I have built in equity. Now, with that equity number, that's the appraised value. So the tax assessor decided that this house is worth $155,000. I could probably sell the house for more than that. On a retail, especially in this market, I could probably sell it for about 160, maybe even 165. And so we're talking about 40K plus in equity, right? Again, for a house I spent nothing on. And that was the first day of, I closed the first day in November. That was the first property I was able to pick up in November, and it's done well so far, and it's only gonna do better. And then on top of all that, one of the things that I want you guys to know, especially people who are aspiring real estate investors, the numbers are all great, right? I didn't pay anything, I got a good amount of equity, I get cash flow. But what kind of property are you gonna get when the property is paid off? That's very important. This is an emerging neighborhood. Every single house except four or five, there's new construction on the street. Like, a lot of eye traffic came here. It's private community, de-restricted pool, de-restricted golf course, marina, everything. So over time, the value of this home in this neighborhood is gonna go up. And so on top of all that, I get a vacation home whenever I want to. So if I have a stressful day, a stressful week, right, stressful month, I can come out here and relax. I got a golf cart, drive around, you know, go play golf, go fish, go take a boat out on the lake. You can rent boats here. So I got a good asset, cash flowing asset. I got equity from the asset. And I also got an asset that I can actually enjoy, right? One day, of course, I probably will sell it. I am an investor. I probably will sell it, especially if I get another lakefront property that's better and more cash flowing and I think it's a better asset. I probably will sell it. Or I might even decide to just rent it out completely. And then when that happens, I can't come here and everything like that. So, but that's the type of deal that I was able to work through. And that's from one relationship. So my realtor brought this to me. And two, being able to analyze the market for an Airbnb. Because that's one of the things that a lot of people have this misconception is that any house can make money on Airbnb. I'm here to tell you that's not true. There are a lot of houses, most houses, that will do worse than a long-term tenant. The hot spots for Airbnb is near an airport, near a body of water, and near downtown in major metroplexes. And so a lot of people like want an Airbnb, but don't even know how to analyze that. And even with that, sometimes there's not enough data in the area to justify if you can cover your mortgage payments, or if you're doing one of these rental situations, your rent, if you can even make enough from Airbnb to cover that, plus the expenses you'll accumulate, like cleaning, like property management, if you do that. So, but I was only able to do that because I spent the time in learning what makes a good Airbnb property and how it can maximize revenue, cash flow, and income from the property. So that was property one. Property two was actually land. So, of course, you guys know that, you know, we develop some properties here and there. That's actually kind of the core of our business. Now we do wholesale some, everything like that, but we got land for $35,000. I didn't pay for it, private money, right? And how, just so a lot of you know, I talked about this kind of in one of my last videos, talked about the different hands, the different roles within a real estate ecosystem. So a private investor paid for the land, and what we ended up doing is we joint ventured with the builder. And what happens is when the property is sold, we split the profit with the builder. So in this example, the land was $35,000. This is not an example, sorry. This, in this circumstance, this property, $35,000, right? Now, construction, from your member, let me make sure I'm correct, because I don't want to give you guys bad information. But the construction cost about $185,000. So we were all in $185,000 plus $30,000, and we're selling the house for $259,000. So you deduct that, what your construction price was, closing costs, and then of course land costs. The profit in the deal is $44,000, cut in half. So builder walks away with $22,000. We walk away with $22,000. We go our separate ways. So again, I did not pay for that land. I didn't pay for construction. I didn't get a loan. Didn't get my credit pool. Now, the Airbnb property, I got my credit pool, right? This is a mortgage. This is actually an owner-occupied mortgage. But the land, I didn't pay for it at all. I just put my expertise to the table. So that's another one of these things that you're just not going to be able to do unless you have that expertise or you're willing to develop that that expertise, right? And so that's $22,000. So let's backtrack. We got $37,000 from property one with roughly, let's say, $2,500 in cash flow per month on average. Let's just say that. We'll say $2,000. So let's say we're bringing in about $24,000 over the year, in a year. So $24,000 in cash flow per year, $37,000 in equity. And then property two, I got $22,000 when the property sells, which it hasn't sold yet, right? So 37 plus 22, I'm at $59,000. Plus, let's say $24,000 in cash flow per month. That's, I believe, $83,000. I spent $0 besides furniture. I spent $4,000. So that's the power of real estate if you're willing to develop the skill. Now, property three is my favorite and the most interesting. And again, before I really dive into the specifics of this, I'm gonna let you guys know that this strategy is very complex. And I do not recommend you going out and trying to do this by yourself, especially if it's your first time like investing in real estate. And now that property is literally down the street. Now, I mentioned that this entire neighborhood is pretty much new construction, besides like four or five houses. I own one of them. So all this eye traffic is coming here with all this new construction. And there's this house over there that needs a little bit of work that's actually the biggest on the street, right? And I got that house using $2,500. I bought an entire house for $2,500. So, backtrack. $0 first property. $0 second property. $2,500 for number three. So I'm all in $2,500. Now, that property could sell on the market today for about $150 maybe. Let's say $150, right? I got to put in a little bit of lipstick, cosmetic work. So let's say $5,000 in repairs or in rehab. It could sell for $160, right? It's a $160,000 house. It's huge, almost 2,000 square feet, right? Almost twice the size of the Airbnb property, right? I bought that house subject to. Now, again, I go back. I talked about being in the right place at the right time. I got this house on November 1st. I closed on November 1st. 3 weeks later, a lot of my mail kept getting delivered to a different address. And so what happened was this woman would call me saying, "Hey, are you Mikhail? I have your mail here." Because I was you know, getting shipments from all kinds of furniture stuff. So I got your mail here. So I go by there and pick up her stuff. I see a for sale by owner sign. Now, I love for sale by owner because they've made it obvious they're looking to sell and they're not using a realtor and you can negotiate with them directly. I love that. So I sat down with the owner and basically was like, "Hey, you know, what's the situation? Why are you looking to sell? You know, why aren't you using a realtor? Why are you picking that price point?" So she was selling for like 119, 120, 125. And basically she bought the house a couple of years ago and she was trying to, she was behind on mortgage payments, right? So the $2,500 I gave was actually to catch her up. So in her pocket, she really didn't get anything. It was to catch her up. She was behind a couple of months, right? And so she was trying to sell it for like 119 and she was trying to sell it as is. So when you're selling something as is, you're selling out most of the time to an investor. Most investors use the same type of formulas. They want to go 70% of the ARV, 65% of the ARV, 75% of the ARV. somewhere around there, right? So they can get the most value when they flip the property. Her loan on the property was $100,000. So let's do some math really quick. Let's do some math. Okay. Let's say got a $150,000 mortgage. Okay. Or let's say $150,000 retail price. If I'm an investor and I'm buying at 70%, that's $105,000, right? Then you want to subtract the repairs. There was no money in it for her at all, right? There was no money in it for her. And that $150,000 might have been a little bit generous, especially if you only put in $5,000 in repairs. So she was right at the point where it would be unfeasible for someone to buy as is, right? So I offered her a solution. I said, hey, what we can do is I can basically take over your payments, right? Now, I didn't go into the bank or to her mortgage company and say, hey, I'm Mikhail. Here's my credit information. This is not my house. No. The loan stays in her name. I just take it over. So I wrote her a $2,500 check. I took possession of the property. Well, technically, she's actually still in there because, you know, we're a service-based business. So she wanted to make sure she could stay in there until her husband was, you know, ready to move. No problem. So we did that, right? So my plan with this property is to wrap another mortgage around it. So I say it could retail for like 160. I'm gonna do a seller finance on it for 160. Get a 10% down payment, so I get 16K up front. And then, you know, the other terms will be discussed later with the new home buyer. So wrap it up. I bought the house subject to using $2,500, right? The house is valued at about $155,000, $160,000. Let's say $160,000, okay? The loan on it now is about $97,000. So let's say I gotta put in about $5,000, $7,000 in lipstick, okay? Or cosmetic work. So that is $104,000, right? That I'm all in for this property for. I got my loan on it, or I got the retail price of it is $160,000. So $160,000 minus $104,000 is $56,000 in equity. I spent $2,500. So let's do the math, right? So I got $56,000, right? Plus $22,000. So that is now $78,000. $78,000 plus another $37,000, that is $115,000. So my net worth went up six figures using $2,500. And that is what I'm trying to stress to you guys, because if you put in the work and the time, that's extremely feasible for you. But if you don't, it's not. And you can still put in the work and the time and just not be in the right situation like I was when I found the subject to property. So if you want to learn more about what we do here at Wise and how I can teach you, how we can teach you how to do things like this and strategically place yourself in the right situations to where the likelihood of you being able to acquire one of these properties increases because you've been strategically placed to be in that situation. We do that. We put you in those situations. We teach you how to structure. We show you the documents. We show you who to go to for a title company, closing attorney, whatever. You know, how to structure these deals. And then, of course, you put them into play, right? And so, again, warning, this is not a get-rich-quick scheme. This is not something that you can just half do. I'm telling you right now, you cannot half do it. You can't. Because I see all these ads that are going around like how you don't have to quit your job. You know, this is something you can do on the side and make $40,000 a month doing no work. That's just not true. That's not a real thing. So I was able to increase my net worth six figures in 1 month by working hard. That's this video. I increased my net worth six figures in real estate in 1 month by working hard and strategically placing myself in the right situations. So if you want to do that or learn how to do that yourself, you can visit our website, www.wealthandsharingequity.com. Send me an email at monu@wealthandsharingequity.com. Or of course, give me a call. My number is 832-922-3800. Thank you so much for joining. Stay tuned for the next one. And let's go.